Mansfield.
The worst thing EA has ever done is stop making Strike games. The literal worst. The company has done nothing worse. No, not even that. Because the Strike games were, at their best, incredibly good fun, and even at their worst were playable and a bit of a lark. Even so, it was a series that lived and died across just 6 years in the 1990s. But why? I don't really know. I don't think it was entirely justified for the series to be summarily executed as it was, and I absolutely believe the Strike series would be a wonderful one for EA to bring back, so long as it wasn't a free-to-play Trojan horse for NFTs, or whatever's cool in corporate land these days. Whatever the case, it's probably worth a chunk of chat about the series, so I'll do that then. Let's go back to 1992. It had been just over a year since the end of hostilities in the First Gulf War, a combat campaign that featured judicious use of one AH-64 Apache attack helicopter. And when I say one, I mean loads, and not just one single chopper. That probably wouldn't have worked quite as well. Anyway, a year and a bit following the cessation of hostilities in a war that saw plenty of successful use of a very recognisable battle vehicle. So why not release a video game where you pilot an Apache in a combat campaign across a fictionalised Middle Eastern nation? Why not indeed? That game was, of course, Desert Strike. And just to hammer home how this wasn't a coincidence in the slightest, the game's subtitle was Return to the Gulf, a year and a bit after the war ended. Stay classy, games industry. Thing is, though, Desert Strike's setting was actually somewhat fortuitous, if that's the right word to use. The game was in the works before Allied forces decided to go in and ruffle Saddam's mustache, with development beginning, or at least planning beginning, in the 80s. Originally set in Lebanon because of the Lebanese Civil War, oh for fuck. The game was first known as Beirut Breakout, then Apache AHX Desert Madman, and had absolutely nothing to do with the real-world conflict it eventually became known for. Just a different, smaller real-world conflict. But it was the onset of the First Gulf War and the massive coverage it got across the world's media that managed to put a different spin, like a rotor blade, on the initial idea. As good and timely as that setting was at getting eyeballs on the product, I'm still 30 years later in some kind of shock that they literally called it Return to the Gulf, the cheeky buggers. The fact is, none of it would have mattered or stood any test of time were Desert Strike not any good. But Desert Strike was definitely good. Brilliant, even. It blended arcade and simulation action wonderfully well and resulted in a game that offered exciting moment-to-moment combat across multiple missions in a series of levels, alongside the need to manage your fuel and ammunition, the ability to take on missions in a largely non-linear fashion, and the chance to immediately forget you're supposed to keep an eye on your fuel and crash in the middle of the desert while looking for POWs to extract. There had been games along similar lines to Desert Strike previously, like Choplifter, which was a direct named influence on EA's game, but there was also the less well-known first release from One Will Wright, Raid on Bungling Bay, that Desert Strike owes a clear debt to. But just like it using the Gulf War as a marketing tool, these influences fell by the wayside when you got into the new game because, wait, I've already said it was brilliant. But it was. It was brilliant. Desert Strike was initially made for the Mega Drive, but you'll find I've not actually been playing that version most of the time here, instead opting for the actually genuinely superior Amiga port. It looked and sounded far better than the original, even if it wasn't quite there with the controls. Ports landed, or took off, or span out of control on plenty of other formats too, with the SNES getting its port that few cared about, and plenty of paired-back handheld ports doing the rounds in the early 90s. They varied in quality, but that initial Mega Drive version was so good that, just like using the Gulf War as a marketing tool and just like piggybacking off the mechanics of Choplifter on Raid and Bungling Bay, it didn't matter how the game fared in its ports. It was an instant classic. Back to the chopper and back to the Mega Drive. The first sequel moved things from the desert to the jungle in 1993, a year after that initial game launched. And what changed with it? Well, for one, the Amiga version wasn't better than that of the Mega Drive, so I'm sticking with the console original here for footage. Beyond that, it was a case of standard sequel, really. More missions, more variety, including, yes, jungles, nighttime missions, a bigger capacity cartridge to cram it all in, and you even got to control different vehicles at certain points, the stealth fighter in particular being hot garbage to get behind the wheel of. I assume they do have steering wheels. I'm not a plane scientist. Expectations were high, as you'd expect, and Jungle Strike largely lived up to them. It was by no means a bold reinvention of the format, but it really didn't need to be by this point. It refined the formula, speeding things up nicely and broadening the variety of missions enough to make things feel a bit fresher than it would have been were it a straightforward remix of the first game. The additional vehicles, though, felt like a logical step to take, but really weren't much more than a gimmick, and good crikey, the hovercraft was trash. Were I a cynical person, I might say this was an early indication of things to come and how eventually, quickly, the series would run out of steam as focus was placed on gimmicks being introduced to try and keep things fresh, rather than looking at more important reinventions and refinements of a wonderful initial format. And I am a cynical person, so I will say that, but I've already said it, so there's no need to go over it again. Jungle Strike was good, but it was good in the way a second pint of water on a hot day is. You've already had the refreshing delight of the first pint. This one's just being imbibed because the first was so good. And it's a bit warmer, and it doesn't feel as refreshing. And you know it'll just make you need to wee more. I'm not saying Jungle Strike was just future piss, it was a good sequel after all, but there was an increased risk of piss thanks to some of the game's gimmicky introductions. No, I have no idea why I'm comparing a game to piss. Next! The law of diminishing returns started to show its face when EA went back to the Gulf Jungle City? Oh, it's because it's an urban jungle. Jesus. Urban Strike was well received by the critics of the day, and there was certainly warmth for it in the gaming community. It's not like this was a turd sandwich of a game, not by a long shot. But it was that third pint of water, and the liquid was getting tepid by 1994. Safe to say the impact of the next generation of consoles, Sega's Saturn and Sony's PlayStation, even Sega's 32X, potentially, that new breed of machines had unleashed an enticing aroma onto the gaming community, making them float up in the air like a cartoon dog hovering towards a pie in a window. I assume that still happens in cartoons these days. I'm not a cartoon scientist. But there was a shift in focus, in attention, in what players wanted. So it was that while Urban Strike was a good game, in many ways the best of the series, albeit with rough around the edges on foot sections, clearly crowbarred in there to forcefully mix things up, while it was a good game, it didn't quite have that popular impact each of the previous entries to the series did. Sure, it was another good Strike game, but hadn't you heard? We were about to move into the true 3D generation of gaming, with stone-cold classics like Killiac the Blood, Criticom, and Cyber Speedway on the horizon. How could EA's near future chopper-em-up possibly compete? I'm going to mention this now, it's as good a time as any and I don't want to forget. Desert Jungle and Urban Strike all came out on the SNES too. It wasn't the series' home format and EA was renowned in the 90s for releasing substandard ports of its games on Nintendo's machine. The Strikes were no different. Urban Strike in particular saw a genuinely shonky port to SNES, nowhere near on a par with the Mega Drive original. End of port tangent. Had Urban Strike been the first of the series, I know it's impossible, but it's a thought experiment involving time travel or something. Had the third game been the first, I'd wager it'd be the most fondly remembered. It had redefined the basic mechanics, it included multiple vehicles and not the awful hovercraft, it was nice and weird, there was a mission where you flew underground, and it stepped away from the mostly straightforwardly jingoistic, racially stereotyping war blasting, though oh boy howdy they'd come back to that with gusto, and generally speaking Urban Strike was just good. But it being third in line meant its potential impact was dulled. The format for the series already established, and those on-foot sections really felt rather gimmicky in a way that wasn't entirely pleasant. There was just nothing particularly surprising about it, outside of some spikes of weirdness. As I said, reviews of Urban Strike were positive, but critics and players had obviously cooled on the series. It was a case of diminishing returns, with at least one review stating that EA had taken the Strike games as far as it could. so it was probably time to put the series out to pasture, right?
You probably think I'm finished, huh?
Nope, there was money involved after all. But, less cynically, as if you can say that with a straight face when talking about EA, there was also a legitimate reason to keep the Strike series going, that new generation of consoles. The Saturn hit in 1994, Sony's first ever games machine arrived in 1995, and in late 1996 we saw the arrival of Soviet Strike, which came to those two machines, which is why I mentioned them. And my word, what a mid-90s new generation of gaming assault on the senses Soviet Strike was. Backed by a slick, aggressive marketing campaign, new 3D graphics, and flavor-of-the-month full-motion video sequences, the game was pushed everywhere, pushed hard, and the phrase, "Stop these wars before they happen," still rattles around my brain to this day, decades later, which is worrying, so let's not unpack that here. All of this operated as something of a smokescreen, though, because Soviet Strike, it was good, it was okay. I enjoyed it, the game being one of the few I owned for the PlayStation in those early days, meaning it was one I put a lot of time into, but it was lacking polish, lacking actual new ideas, lacking a clear sense of direction, in multiple senses of the word. I can't say it felt rushed per se, it was a slick production in many ways, but there were many rough edges, many pitfalls of the then still fairly new 3D tech being used, and too much about it that just felt a bit old-fashioned and boring. Even the Saturn port, which was objectively better than the PlayStation original, couldn't quite fix the general feeling this was all a bit dull. Setting-wise, well, look. Rogue elements from former Soviet bloc nations are the baddies. The first mission takes place in Crimea. There's plenty of talk of invasions of Europe. It's very 90s in how it doesn't even question the ethics of clandestine paramilitary organizations operating without governmental oversight. It's uncomfortable, frankly, and the jingoism hurts my head. I will admit Boris Yeltsin featuring in the final mission as a drunk driver is genuinely quite funny, but the rest of it needs to be seen as a product very much of its time, and something that makes me go "yish" a lot while playing it here in the middle of 2022, but that's probably another thing to not try and unpack here, or this will become a 300 hour long video. Soviet Strike could easily give you a good time should you put in the hours, and by no means was it a bad game, but it was starting to feel increasingly like the ship had sailed. Or the chopper had chopped? It was starting to feel like the series was outdated, I mean, and the focus of players had now shifted elsewhere. We were all about the Tekkens and Virtua Fighters of the world, or the Ridge Racers and Daytonas, while EA itself was increasingly more about the FIFAs and Maddens of the world. In the mid-90s, the publisher still had plenty of space for other franchises, don't get me wrong, but already it was at the point where an older series with a dwindling fanbase would find itself very much on the chopping block. The Soviet option wasn't a resounding success, so EA's response was obvious. It took the nuclear option.
It's pronounced nuclear.
Soviet Strike let you fly the helicopter. And nothing else. A step back from Jungle and Urban Strike, which included multiple vehicles. Nuclear Strike, the 1997 follow-up, allowed you to take the helm of 15 different vehicles, as well as introducing some real-time strategy sections every now and then. Were it the first sequel in the series, it might be seen as a grand upgrade for the second run-out. It wasn't the first sequel, it was the fourth, and all of these additions felt like a case of throwing everything into the mix, seeing what would work, seeing what could work, what might help to bring the franchise back to the prominence it once enjoyed. Nuclear Strike was a letdown, even more so than Soviet Strike had been a year earlier. Well, technically 10 months earlier. Yes, Nuclear had a quick turnaround, which painted quite the picture of how EA was handling things by this point. Aside from throwing in poorly refined new features in the hope some of it might stick, or being able to boast about its massive vehicle numbers on the back of the box, I've no idea why they bothered letting you drive a tank. There were few notable changes to Nuclear Strike's formula. Isometric-ish 3D viewpoint, multiple missions you could play in any order if you so choose, more of those wonderfully 90s FMV sequences. Winches? It was Strike, for the fifth time, and while plenty who played it did enjoy it, including Nintendo owners who got their own slightly different version with Nuclear Strike 64, in objective terms it could never be seen as much more than a by-the-numbers addition to a series that had run out of ideas. It also included some, at best, woefully misjudged Vietnam War, I don't know, tributes? Strafing Riverside soldiers in a Huey is just a bit uncomfortable, even if it is all a bit cartoonish in its presentation.
Terrorists can make the bomb. The question is, can we stop them? Nuclear Strike.
While Nuclear Strike wasn't a complete failure, the impact of the game was, following the now established pattern, dulled. The franchise had made the leap into the PlayStation era and had made a good try of it, but the mixed quality of the Soviet and nuclear strikes meant it was no longer the subject of any particular hype, and it certainly wasn't the talk of the playground like Desert Strike once was, in no small part because few of us who'd enjoyed Desert Strike at its prime were still in playgrounds by that point. Where once the Strike games had been essential and exciting, it was now a series that felt overplayed, old-fashioned, and like a bit of a relic. We didn't actually know it at the time, but in 1997, 5 years after it started, the Strike series died.
Oh, I'm going slap happy.
For those paying attention to the words I used earlier on, you may be wondering why I said this was a series that lasted just 6 years. 1992 to 1997 covers 5 years after all. Fair enough, you know your year maths, but there was another Strike Orca, which works actually because there was walking in it. The ending of Nuclear Strike set the stage for the next evolution of the Strike series, promising something would arrive soon by the name of Future Strike. A reinvention for the series, it would move away from the vaguely realistic combat scenarios of the franchise so far and push it into a bold world of gritty, cyberpunky sci-fi. Thing is though, Future Strike never came out. EA decided to rip the in-development game out from the Strike series and instead push it as its own thing. I couldn't find a concrete reason why, but you have to assume it's the exact reasons I mentioned in the last section because I'm just that smart and insightful. Thus, in 1998, Future Cop LAPD released on the PlayStation and soon after on PC and Mac. Technically speaking, it wasn't a Strike game, but the heritage was clear. A vehicle pootling around in a map, engaging in objectives and shooting plenty of people into red chunks. Only this time around the vehicle transformed, the setting was late 21st century Los Angeles, and you were a domestic cop instead of a paid-up member of the world's secret police. The urge to get into how Future Cop LAPD would go down in today's climate is strong, and there's a huge part of me that is at best bemused by the game's obsession with the honourable iron fist of the law, and at worst sickened by it? Hey, guess what? Not one to unpack today. But Future Cop is still one of my favourite games. A triumph of mechanics, creativity and atmospheric setting all blending together to make the best Strike game that never was. And, well, that was it. Since 1998, there has been nary a mention of Desert Jungle Urban Soviet Nuclear or Future from the lips of EA. The company has probably used those individual words, of course, but not in the context of referring to these games. The series half-died in 1997, fully died in 1998, was resurrected for the Superb EA Replay on PSP in 2006, which included emulated versions of Desert and Jungle Strike, and since then, just may as well not have existed. There was a sudden, insurmountable rise for Desert Strike in 1992, backed by a wave of media and public attention as it bolted itself onto a then-recent real-world conflict. It backed up this controversy courting with a superb and original game that bridged the gap between arcade and simulation with real skill. But from day one, this was a series in a tailspin. Each successor did worse than the game before it, either in sales or critical reception. It might not have been as spectacular a crash as it was a rise for the Strike series, it might have been somewhat predictable as the years and new releases passed, but it was no less jarring a crash when Strike finally did hit the ground again. It was once a wonderful series, it's still a fine collection of games, and it's the exact sort of thing you'd hope a publisher as money-hungry as EA would be keen to resurface. Just maybe don't riddle it with things I can't bring myself to unpack right now, eh? Thanks for watching, and I appreciate those of you who've waited patiently for this video to hit. I had a long, unexpected break, but it's good to be back talking wank, so anonymous dillweeds in the comments can call me out on a technicality or think they're being clever by badly hiding their racism. Ah, the internet. Here's my $5 or more patrons from Patreon, who I love like stepchildren. And here's my higher tier patrons, who I love like slightly taller stepchildren. Paintball Magazine, PBM, Lola Osman, Takara Hoshi. Right, I'm off to return to the golf. Bye!
I didn't forget about